proceeding with the next academic session, I would like Dr. T.D. Yadav to say a few words about Dr. Kaushik.
Good afternoon and good evening, friends. I requested Professor Kaushik to talk about training in HPV surgery, and this is the, I think, the moment I cannot explain in words. And he has been my guru in Sanjay Gandhi PGI, and then I went somewhere and he picked me up from there, lifted and took me with him to Government Medical College Chandigarh, and then I came here because of his blessings and support. So I just wanted all my colleagues that in our mythology, if you go to Ramchaitmanas, the first shloka, first doha is about guru. And if you have a good guru, then so many things can be clear for you. And I stop by saying only two lines by Tulsidas ji, and he writes that first doha, I don't know how many of you know, many of our younger generation doesn't know. Bandho Gurupad Kanj Kripa Sindhu Naru Bhari and Mahamuvatam Punja Jasu Vachandra Vikarnikar. कि ऐसा गुरु होना चाहिए कि जिसकी बात, जो आपकी बात है, जो इस संसार में अंधकार है उसमें एक रोशनी की तरह काम करे. सो दैट्स व्हाई आई टुक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी व्हाट्सएवर इज माला बिग टू इंट्रोड्यूस सर. एंड सर प्लीज कम एंड गिव सम टिप्स फॉर द ट्रेनिंग इन एचपीवी सर्जरी.
गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स एंड कलीग्स. वेरी हार्टनिंग टू सी the progress over the years, and I think TD sometime talked a little about training in HPV surgery, and I would start with the preamble. Came across this saying while I was working on history of surgery. Men make their own history, but they do not make it just as they please or under the circumstances of their own choosing. The pioneers had to fight a strong opposition, deep-rooted prefixed ideas and conservative perceptions in order to create independent specialty of surgical district. The war cry was, what would general surgery be without surgical district? Residual surgery? Surely it is not so. Today, I'm happy to see first to be around, and two, that SGD is at its best. It has made phenomenal progress over the years and further evolved into subspecialities. Avinash and I were just talking a little while ago, and he was saying each subspecialty is now getting on to be an independent sort of specialty in its own right. And you know the various subspecialties which have come over the years. Today there are a number of independent departments and centers of surgical gastroenterology and HPV surgery, with or without training facilities leading to NCH or DND or certificate courses and fellowships. And I think all those who are interested in this line of surgery should take advantage of those. The high volume centers have resulted in better clinical care, there is no doubt about it, lower mortality rates and high quality research in our own environment. And most importantly, it has provided a greater training potential. If the next generation is going to be little more better trained than I was, I think one should think that one has achieved one's goal. Is the training in SPV surgery synonymous with training in any other branch of surgery? Yes and no. After all, what is surgery? Surgery is exposure, identification of structures, division, repair, or bypass. These are the things you do no matter what surgery you are doing, whether you are doing cardiac, whether you are doing neuro, whether you are doing pediatric or any. But the special nature of composition of digestive juices, varied anatomical configurations of organs and their complicated physiological potential creates a very difficult technical challenge for the hepatobiliary surgeon. The training program, to my way of thinking, should at least be for 3 years full time. Shorter period after those people who have done an MCH in surgical gastroenterology could be considered. A exposure of this nature is welcome. Not all of you would be 3 years training program, not all of you would be post-MCH, but getting an assistant and say no, eventually we agreed and we used to have 1 month training program for the surgical residents in endoscopy. And I think that is an important part of it. But the most important is hands-on experience. As I said, it is welcome and it is good that you have a training program of this nature, but for a surgeon, unless you have hands-on experience of your own, you cannot get that confidence, you cannot become that confident of dealing with a situation. I mean, you can see, I could feel even the best of people here, the most expert, when they were talking about bilirubin, they were talking about, there was a certain amount of apprehension and hesitation in one's mind. But having done 50 or number of cases, the confidence would grow further. So I think hands-on experience is most important. And when we talk of 3 years training, we commonly or normally say that first year, you by and large see what is happening, you get tuned to the specialty. In second year, you assist, and in third year, you perform with help or without. Each one of you, after 3 years, should be independently operating and doing the most difficult case on your own. Of course, hands-on training is not alone. Attending these courses is not alone. You must log everything what you have performed so far. Logbook, data collection, record keeping and audit is one of the things we have to insist upon, and you have to. Audit of individual results, audit of team performance, audit of department performance must be done. Computerization has no doubt helped, but accountability has to be there. You could feed anything you want into the computer, and the figures would come out to 0% more. So you need to be accountable, you need to be honest and sincere. And the training is not one-sided. One part of the training is the trainee himself. And you must have aptitude as well as 100% commitment to work. As a young person, you don't realize this. But these are the best years of your life to learn. They're never going to come back. Never ever in your lifetime you are going to have these 3 years of learning as you have now. So you have to have 100% commitment. Sincerity and honesty are virtues which have never been appreciated more and needed more than in a specialty service. What about the trainer? He must have qualities to train. There is no direct conflict or competition between the trainer and the trainee. this feeling should never come. Unfortunately, it does come, and that's why I'm mentioning it here. There's no competition between me and any one of you for that matter. So there is no competition between the trainee and the trainer, and it shouldn't spoil your equation. A trainer must give more than think of self gains or self esteem. More a trainer gives you, I think his gains indirectly become much more itself. We need to, as a trainer, you need to follow ethics, both in professional as well as your personal conduct. No denying about it. The third equation is the infrastructure, the place of work where you are, the equipment which you have been provided, and the other facilities. And these are absolute essential. You can't have a hepatobiliary surgery unit in a place where there is not even a C-arm available. So I think absolute essential is the infrastructure. You need to, the center needs to keep up with day-to-day technological advances, replace and repair equipment. The spirit of collective working and team coordinated effort is mandatory. I think this needs to be underlined once again. You cannot perform surgery as an individual. Surgery is a team. You are operating with people, you are operating as a team, you are looking after the patient as a team. You can't be sitting 24 hours with the patient. The resident would perhaps do a 24-hour duty, but then it has to be a team, and you have to have a very cohesive team to do so. And the onus for this is squarely lies with the chief and the crew members. There has to be that kind of provision for a good setup and training. In the end, my personal wish and advice, there's no greater pleasure in life but to be a teacher. Today, that pleasure has become even more. Please train more and more people to my youngsters on this side. And I wish I could have trained more people, but God willing. I have always believed, I've said on the rounds in Sunday many times, and I still wish that if ever I need surgery, it should be one of my trained residents to operate. Then only I would consider my training.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable guidance. Moving forward, I would now like to invite Dr. Naveen Kalra, Additional Professor of at Department of Radiodiagnosis at PGI Chandigarh, for his talk on endovascular therapy of liver tumors.
Great words of wisdom from you, sir. And at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Yal for inviting me to speak on this topic in this conference on endovascular therapy of liver tumors. So, like to classify the interventional techniques that a radiologist can do in liver tumors, there would be primarily catheter-based endovascular techniques, which is going to be what I'm going to talk about today, which includes transarterial hemoembolization and embolization with drug-eluting beads, and then the yttrium-90 radiotherapy. What we are doing in our department at PGI at present is that we are restricting ourselves to TACE and drug-eluting bead TACE. In my future talk, I will probably refer this to as conventional TACE and this to as neo TACE. And then there are the different ablative techniques which have a different patient selection, which is different from these endovascular techniques. So first and foremost, the role of these endovascular techniques in the primary liver tumors, that is hepatocellular carcinoma, as all of you are aware, surgery is definitely the treatment of choice for SCC. And 70 to 80% are unsuitable for resection due to the advanced tumor stage or poor liver reserve. So this is where the endovascular therapy comes in, and I'm sure most of you are conversing with this BCLC staging, the Barcelona Clinic Liver Cancer Staging System, which not only gives the staging but also directs us to the form of therapy that we would adopt in patients with hepatocellular carcinoma. So where does endovascular therapy stand here? It is indicated for the intermediate stage hepatocellular carcinoma, multinodular, with a good performance status. So for lesions which are either more than 5 cm or if there are 3 nodules which are more than 3 cm, then is the role of the endovascular therapy. If you go strictly by these guidelines, you would exclude patients who have main motor vein invasion and not do transarterial hemoembolization in them, and they would then go in for sorafenib therapy. So by definition, according to the Society of Interventional Radiology guidelines, TACE is defined as the infusion of a mixture of chemotherapeutic agents with or without iodized oil, which is followed by embolization with particles. So the rationale of doing TACE is that hepatocellular carcinoma is fed primarily from the hepatic arteries, and the amount of arterial flow is to the tune of 5 to 7 times more than that what is being given to the tumor than to the surrounding normal liver parenchyma. A normal liver parenchyma, as you are aware, has a dual supply from the portal vein and the hepatic arteries. So for patient selection, again stressing, these are patients, non-surgical patients with a tumor more than 5 cm or multifocal tumors more than 3 in number. But we have to see that the tumor burden should usually be less than 50%. Some of the studies say that even if the tumor size is more than 10 cm, you should not do this. And it only for tumors which are between 5 and 10 centimeters in size. The bilirubin level should be less than 3 milligrams per deciliter, and then preserved renal function and preserved marrow reserve should be there. We would like to exclude patients who are child class C, or those with biliary obstruction, and those with main portal vein thrombosis. If you have thrombosis in the right and the left portal vein, it's only a relative contraindication, and you can go ahead and do TACE in such patients. So for the technique, it is important to be aware of the hepatic arterial anatomy and the various variants that are there in the hepatic arterial tree. And then you selectively access the hepatic arteries via the common femoral artery, using first a guiding catheter, and then you put in a micro catheter through the guiding catheter. We just use one agent, that's doxorubicin, emulsified with 10 ml of lipidol. And lipidol, which is the hepatized poppy seed oil, it serves not only as a carrier for the hemotoxic agent, but because of it being viscous, it results in temporary vascular embolization as well. And once you've done with this, you inject gel form, which is an embolic agent, to decrease the drug washout. This was a patient who had this hypervascular tumor. You can see this is the arterial phase and this is the arterial dense aorta. There is no contrast visualized in the IVC, and you see the arterial channels, the new vascular channels, and the increased vascularity. Compare it with the normal liver parenchyma. And this is the venous phase, in which you see the portal vein being opacified. It is patent, there is no thrombus here, and the washout in the tumor here. So in this patient, did an SMA run first. So doing a superior mesenteric artery run at present is debatable, because you get all the information about the variant hepatic arterial anatomy on the CT angiogram, and as also you get information on the status of the portal vein on the CT only. So this phase you may do to look at the average supply, and then do the hepatic artery run, and when you identify the selective vessel feeding the tumor, you go into it using a micro catheter and do your complete your TACE procedure. Other patient, the SMA run, then the celiac run, and then go could identify this vessel from the right hepatic artery, and we've accessed almost till the vessel feeding branches, so that we do not embolize any of the, we don't do any non-target embolization. And this is after the procedure, you see the hepatol deposited within the tumor. So post phase, you, for next 24 hours, after 24 hours, you do a non-contrast CT to look at the distribution of the lipidome within the tumor. So if there is dense uptake within the tumor, you can see here, and there is no uptake in the rest of the liver. So as far as the outcome after taste is concerned, these were the two prospective studies, randomized controlled trials, which showed that comparing taste with the supportive care, there was definitely a survival advantage at 3 years and at 2 years. Now, advantage being that with the taste, you are injecting the anti-cancer drugs into the artery and high tumoral concentration is achieved. The side effects are minimal, and this is definitely relatively inexpensive compared to other endovascular techniques that are available for NCC. All of your patients are likely to have post-embolization syndrome, but they usually resolve within a week in the form of pain, nausea, fever, and malaise, and you treat them symptomatically. There are other potential risks like the liver abscess, liver infarctions of failure, liver tumor rupture, and you can, may sometimes land up doing a non-target embolization when you will have pancreatitis, cholecystitis, and other complications. So you have to be careful with deployment of your catheter and microcatheter. So moving now to NeoTACE. So what is NeoTACE is where drug-eluting beads are used, and these are polyvinyl alcohol-based microspheres. They are loaded with the chemotherapeutic agents and are delivered intra-arterially. So the utility being that there is simultaneous delivery of uniform embolic and chemotherapeutic agents. So it allows you fixed dosing and ability to release the drug in a sustained and controlled manner. This is how the beads come. There is a supernatant which is expelled, and this is the doxorubicin which is loaded and in 2 ml of water. So then you mix these two, and when you have to wait for 30 minutes. In India, we do not have the preloaded beads, so you have to wait for 30 minutes till the drug is loaded onto the beads. And once that is done, then you add contrast, that is about 15 to 20 ml. So you have finally about 20 ml to be injected when you are doing NeoTACE. So what happens is that there is a bond between the sulfonyl amide and the protonated amines of the doxorubicin and the beads, and the utility being that you achieve a high level within the tumor and a low level within the plasma, vis-a-vis conventional taste where it would be a higher level in the plasma. So this is a phase 2 precision 5 trial which showed the utility of DC beads versus conventional taste, and showed definitely it was a better response with conventional NeoTACE. And again, they looked at the 6-month response in patients with NeoTACE, and they found that if the this was more advanced disease, the outcome was better with drug-eluting beads than conventional taste. Again, the adverse effects were less when the drug-eluting beads were used versus the conventional taste. So the patient where we did the drug-eluting beads, and this you see here is not a very vascular tumor. This is the arterial phase, this is the venous phase. There is some washout, but we were not sure where, because of the lack of vascularity, when we did the DSA, there was, we could not identify the vessel. This is how it looked on the MR, right, on T2 weighted images, and patchy enhancement on the contrast images. So when we did the celiac angiogram, we actually were not very sure which vessel we would direct our therapy towards. So luckily now we have the facility of doing a CT scan, a C-arm CT scan in our DSA suite. And this is a low dose CT, and when we placed our catheter within the feeding vessel and did a CT, you can see the distribution of the, this is a, just the iodinated contrast. So if you see the distribution of the iodinated contrast and match it with the anatomical location of the tumor, and you are sure that even in hypovascular tumors, you are directing the therapy at the correct place. And this helped us in doing a targeted chemoembolization with drug-eluting beads. For completion's sake, I'll talk about titanium microspheres. These are now available, but they are very expensive. They are coming as insoluble glass or resin microspheres. We have beta radiation, and the radiation is emitted within the first 11 days after treatment. But the size of particles being small, you can deploy them within the arteries feeding the HCC, and the mean penetration being 2.5 mm, and they cannot penetrate more than 11 mm. So what happens is, when you give it in this artery feeding the tumor, these particles get entrapped, and what happens is you give higher doses of radiation to smaller volumes and have greater tumoricidal effect with minimal damage to the non-tumor tissue around the HCC. Again, you have to do, before the procedure, you have to look for the vasculature, the anatomy, and because you do not want any non-targeted therapy here, you have to actually coil embolize the GDA and the right gastric vessel, and then determine the shunt fraction, because you do not want a lot of your, more than 20% of your radiation going to the lung, as that would lead to lung radiation pneumonitis. So you have to do a scan prior to the therapy to determine how much is the shunt fraction. The advantage that is being mooted for this therapy is that it is well tolerated even with portal vein thrombosis. And this happens to be just a relative contraindication vis-a-vis TACE, where you would not like to do it if there is main portal vein embolization. And then there is less post-embolization syndrome, and the particles infused are not intended to cause total arterial occlusion, so the post-embolization symptoms are less vis-a-vis conventional taste and drug-eluting bead taste. But then the complications, there's a long list of complications like the radiation ulcers, the fatigue, pain, nausea, vomiting, will be toxicity and the drop in the counts. And then you can have gallbladder injury or radiation pneumonitis. Now there is a talk about doing combination therapies, like combining the endovascular therapies with the ablative techniques, which means you combine the transarterial therapies with the RFA. And what is the hypothesis for that is you increase the tumor sensitization to the heat kill with RFA following the TACE. And normally your RFA zone of kill is less than 5 centimeters, but if you combine it with TACE, then it increases the ablative zone to 6 to 7 centimeters and decrease the recurrence rates following the procedure. And this is again some of the studies which have shown that combination therapy extends the ablated area and decreases the local tumor progression. Bland embolization, transarterial embolization, has been advocated for use in ruptured HCC. And here again it is said that any lesion should be considered for surgery if it is a low risk curative resection. But PAE is indicated when liver function is compromised or in the case of multifocal bilobar HCC, in cases which where resection is not to be done. So moving on briefly to the role of endovascular therapy in metastasis, just a couple of slides there. As far as neuroendocrine tumor metastasis is concerned, this is the recommendation given by the European Neuroendocrine Tumor Society. And it says that when you have well-differentiated metastases, which are based on the Ki-67, Ki-67 expression on histochemistry and the number of mitosis per high power period. So if it is a well-differentiated metastasis and it is in both lobes of the liver, so it is a type 2 kind of metastasis, you have surgery as option, but in case surgery is contraindicated, then the role of transarterial chemoembolization comes. Transarterial chemoembolization is also indicated in type 1, which means an isolated metastasis to the liver, where surgery is contraindicated. So that is the role of TACE vis-a-vis neuroendocrine tumors. Moving on to the role of endovascular therapy in colorectal metastasis. This was a phase 3 trial where they have used the drug-eluting bead that I talked earlier, used doxorubicin. So here iron norticon has been used, and they have found that when comparing it with the chemotherapy, the overall survival, progression-free survival and quality of life was significantly better when the drug-eluting beads were used. We do not have any experience of using drug-eluting beads with metastasis at present. And as far as radioembolization is concerned, again there are phase 3 trials which have which are looking into the role of radioembolization therapy with endovascular therapy in colorectal metastasis. So to conclude, endovascular therapy has the importance that it has minimal toxicity, maximum response, and the most effective embolic and chemotherapeutic agents that you are going to use has not been defined because there are no RCTs to it, but according to the institutional preference, they are used. At present, it is commonest to use for HCC, it is commonest to use doxorubicin as a single drug. And if when you use the neotase, that is the drug-eluting beads, doxorubicin embolization, it offers improved tumor response and decreased side effects. Thank you very much. An effort for patients for doing this. One is that if the patient is having an HCC, and in addition, we see there are maybe some large portal lymph nodes. So if you go strictly by these recommendations, you would not like to do tests. But a lot of times we get referrals to do tests in such cases where the tumor size is only 5 to 6 centimeters, but you have extra hepatic metastasis in the form of lymph nodes. So if somebody would share what they would do in their setting, one. And second is, because if I go by literature, there is no recommendation for doing tests for downsizing and then operating. But I have gone through articles where some researchers say you downsize, not too many, one or two, where they say downsize and then operate. So anybody would like to share their experiences with regarding these two things. And then there are more queries or questions, I will be ready to answer them.
Because the applicant within a year is very, very high. So they have done in this Hong Kong group by Professor Lau. They have published the results of multimodality treatment and then surgery. So if a tumor is larger size, even in a non-cirrhotic liver, which might do a right extended, only surgery, no? But they are doing endotherapy and then they are going ahead and doing hepatectomy, and they have shown that the results is better when compared to surgery alone in giant SCC.
But I think
lymph node in this very few people, I have read some articles where it is said that it's a very myth that SCC doesn't spread to the lymph nodes. Even SCC is spread to the lymph nodes, and the lymph node with SCC, I don't know. Professor Sitaram, Dr. Any experience of SCC in nodal metastasis? We don't have.
So if you have a lymph node which is suspicious of metastasis, you do diphenia on that, prove it to the metastasis, then it's a gone case. It means then you are going to go give the palliative therapy on the form of sorafenib. But if those lymph nodes are negative, in that case, if it's a we're talking about child A patient with normal remaining liver, the large size tumor is not by itself a contraindication for infection. Now, issue is that if there is no vascular thrombus, major vascular thrombus, you can go ahead and do the direct infection. But if there is a right branch of the portal vein, right big tumor, extending into it, in that case, the tear has a role. Even CDCRT has got a role. Yes, you have proved that they're better.
The problem with lymph nodes is like, as you know, that now we do not like to, for making a diagnosis of SCC, we do not like to sample the tumor.
Sample the tumor, you are sampling the node.
But if the lymph node has the tumor,
no, then it's positive, as it is the patient's
positive. Then you are exposing.
No, there is nothing. You are not doing any harm. You are not doing any harm. That's the only question that has come. Disease has gone to the node.
Because if the lymph node, as you were saying, in hepatitis, we usually expect them not to be of more than a centimeter. I'm not sure, but if they're more than a centimeter, then that's the problem there. Usually,
yes.
So you would recommend sampling and
treating. Particularly, you are dealing with a young patient, child A, remaining liver normal, well hypertrophic, and the lesion can be resected. I would like to prove that these are better.
When would you repeat the
for repeating the follow-up of patients by first doing a 24-hour scan to look at the distribution, and then scanning is done at 1 month and then at 3 months. So when we do a scanning at 1 month and we see viable tumor left in cases of days, and if the patient's status, that means he's not gone into decompensated, which if he doesn't go into child C, then is still in child B, then we would like to repeat it at that point of time. But not earlier than a month.
In case of bilobar disease?
In case of bilobar disease, again, I would not like to inject the chemotherapeutic agent earlier than at least a month. Right? Because at one, we've seen that when we've even gone up of doxorubicin at one dose. Because we found that our patients, if we give more than that dose, they have decompensation or the post-embolization syndromes are is more severe, and in those cases they don't tolerate the therapy well. So we wait for that period. If it is the lesion demands that you can give 50 in one and 50 in the other, then we do both the lesions at one.
You don't want to travel just then?
Sorry. Cisplatin, again, there are reports which say if combination therapy works well, but again there are reports if you want to do a single drug, they recommend you use doxorubicin. If you do a single drug, if you want to do a combination, you take cisplatin with the doxorubicin. But if you want to do a single drug, you do this. But again, you have to, patient is in a waiting list. Usually with the smaller tumor, you want to downsize, you can do that, or you can combine it with RFA, because RFA is proposed as bridge to transplantation. So you could use that. But I'm not sure whether we would encounter that problem in our setting.
For our final talk of the day, I would like to invite Dr. Pamicha for his talk on surgical strategy in colorectal liver metastasis. Dr. Pamicha is presently associate professor at IMBS New Delhi.
Planning for the management of CRC liver metastasis and how to increase the number of patients eligible for resection, go through the role of RI population, and I'll go through the strategy in patient with synchronous colorectal liver metastasis. So this is just to look at the natural history of colorectal metastasis. But patient who got resectable disease but they're not resected, their median survival was about 9 months, and the 5-year survival was very rare. So it just shows that surgery provides the main possibility of cure in patient with colorectal liver metastasis. And if you look at the historical data, this is a paper published in British Journal of Surgery back in 1996. And what it said was, if you got more than 4 liver metastases, if you got extrahepatic disease, and if your resection margin is less than a centimeter, you should not be performing liver resection for colorectal liver metastasis. But since then, the things have changed, and as long as you're doing an R0 resection, you can achieve a good 10-year survival, and the disease-free survival also equals to the overall survival at 10 years in patients with R0 resection. But if you get an R1 or R2 resection, then your survival is much, much lesser. And this is irrespective of number of metastases. So in patients with R0 resection, in spite of having large number of metastases, you can still achieve a good long-term survival. And again, it is irrespective of the distribution of disease, whether it is in a single lobe or multiple lobe, it doesn't matter as long as you got an R0 resection. And it doesn't matter what is the margin you get as long as you got an R0 resection. So it is not necessary that you should have at least a centimeter of margin. And even in the presence of extrahepatic tumor, you can achieve a good long-term survival. So this is 17% survival at 5 years, even in the presence of extrahepatic tumor, as long as they are resectable. So if you can resect all the tumor, you can achieve a good long-term survival in this group of patients. So how do we define resectable disease? So before, it was defined based on number of lesions, distribution of lesion, how large the lesion are, and whether there is extrahepatic disease or not. In current era, it is defined based on whether you can achieve an R0 resection, that is a negative margin, irrespective of the size of the margin, and whether you can leave an adequate future level, liver remnant, the most important thing, and even in the presence of extrahepatic disease, if you can resect them all, you can achieve a good long-term survival. So the most important crux here is whether you can leave an adequate future liver remnant. So in cases, if you've got a normal liver, then it is about 25%. But most of these patients with colorectal metastasis would have received chemotherapy at some stage. And the recommendation is to go above 30%. And if there was more cash in your damage, then you should maybe targeting about 35% of future liver remnant. So what are the ways of increasing the number of patients eligible for liver resection? So this can be done either reducing the tumor size, that is by chemotherapy, or increase the hepatic reserve, which can be done by portal vein embolization, or you do a staged liver resection, or you combine the liver resection with an ablation. And in cases of synchronous liver metastasis, because about 25-30% of colorectal liver cancer patients present with synchronous disease, and if you do staged resection in those patients, their liver disease progresses, and they never come down for resection, and they die because of the metastatic disease. So you can either do a simultaneous or you can do a reverse strategy, that is to do the liver resection before you resect the primary. So I'll discuss all this one by one, and I won't go into details of chemotherapy, but chemotherapy has been shown to be beneficial in all three ways, so that is in neoadjuvant setting, in conversion, and in postoperative as an adjuvant setting. In neoadjuvant setting, we've got trials now which suggest that beneficial to give chemotherapy before the liver resection, even in resectable disease. Conversion chemotherapy, that is in patients who have initially unresectable liver metastasis, but then they are downsized, and then you can achieve an R0 resection, and you can achieve a good survival. Post-operative setting, adjuvant chemotherapy again has been shown in retrospective data to be beneficial in preventing recurrent disease. So this is just to show the flowchart of liver metastasis. About 20-25% have resectable disease, and their survival currently is around 60% at 5 years. And most majority of patients will have non-resectable disease. And if you do downsizing chemotherapy, about 10-20% of them will become resectable, and their survival actually is comparable to the ones who have resectable disease. So this is Rennie Adams data from France, and basically it is comparing patients who had initially unresectable disease, they had downstaging chemotherapy, and they had a quality survival of 33% after downsizing chemotherapy, which is pretty much comparable to the initially resectable patient who didn't receive any chemotherapy. So how we increase hepatic reserve? There are two ways. One is to do a portal vein embolization, other is to do a staged liver resection, which can be combined with portal vein embolization. So portal vein embolization, the basic concept is basically if you embolize the one side portal vein, then you get a hypertrophy on the other side because of the hepatic artery buffer response, so that you get a big hypertrophy on the future liver remnant. And so this is just to show that if you've got inadequate future liver remnant, you do an embolization of the right portal vein and you achieve a big hypertrophy on the future liver remnant, and then you can do an extended liver resection. Portal vein embolization meta-analysis has been shown to be safe and effective and can produce good hypertrophy. The meta-analysis suggests the rate of hypertrophy is around somewhere between 15 to 18%, and the rate of complications with portal embolization are the figures are not very big, and it does prevent post-resection liver failure. We have published our own results on portal vein embolization when I was at all free. This was long-term survival and disease recurrence following portal vein embolization. So this was prospectively collected data over a 6-year period, and basically patient with requiring major liver resection of 4 or more segment, and portal vein embolization was done when FLR was less than 30%. These are the numbers. So out of this, 65 extended or right hepatectomy without portal vein embolization, and 22 had extended liver resection after portal vein embolization. Overall, about 36 patients went on had a portal vein embolization done. Out of this, only 22 were went on to have resection. So there was no difference in terms of their demographic characteristic and liver metastatic characteristic. And there was a significant increase in the FLR volume. This median was 295, was increased to 404 ml, and the FLR percent increase was about 10%. And this is the surgical result. I said there was no difference between the two groups in terms of extent of liver resection performed, in terms of size of tumor, resection margin, and post-operative morbidity and mortality. And this is to show this is a survival curve of 36 patients who had portal vein embolization. The ones who had resection after portal vein embolization had a very good survival, and the ones could not have resection after portal vein embolization, the survival was very poor, and there was a significant difference between the two groups. If we compare the ones who had portal vein embolization with our control group, there was no difference in the survival between the two groups, but their disease-free survival was poor. So the patient who had portal vein embolization and went on to have resection, their disease-free survival was inferior to the ones who didn't have portal vein embolization. And this basically raises the question that whether portal vein embolization itself is detrimental. And if you look at the data, if you look at the overall data, published data on portal vein embolization, the overall survival is somewhere around 40%. But the disease-free survival, it is about 20%, median is about 20 months, 12 months. And this issue has been raised previously as well, and people have looked into tumor growth after portal vein embolization. And if you look at the resectability rate, the resectability rate after portal vein embolization is around 70 to 75%. And the disease progression rate is around 20 to 30%. So in order to look at whether portal vein embolization actually has got any effect on the growth rate of colorectal metastasis, we did a case control study and published in British Journal of Cancer. And basically this was to assess the tumor volume at the time of presentation and then to look at the tumor volume at the time of resection, and to do the histological analysis of the resected tumors in terms of looking at the proliferation index, especially the microtit count and the Ki-67 proliferation rate. And what we found, this is just to show the demographic characteristic between the two groups, there was no difference between the two groups. And what we found was the tumor growth rate in the PVE was much higher than the control group, and the mitotic rate was much higher, and the Ki-67 index was much higher in the PVE group. This is just to show the mitosis expression in the control group. You can see there is much more mitosis in the portal vein embolization group. And this is the Ki-67 expression. You can see the more black dots, which suggests that there is more Ki-67 expression in the PVE group. So basically, PVE is a good technique to increase the future liver MNIST, but you need to be cautious about using PVE in routine. You should be very selective in terms of, if you can get a future liver MNIST around 25 to 30%, you should go without PVE. But if you can't get a future liver MNIST between 25 to 30%, then you should go for a PVE. But then you should combine PVE with chemotherapy. So you should give chemotherapy before and after the PVE, in order that the tumor doesn't increase there is no increase in the growth rate of the tumors. So stage resection has become popular. Basically, it is clearing the one lobe of the liver. So if you've got a bilobar metastasis, then you clear up the one lobe of the liver, and then you can either combine with the portal vein embolization if the future liver MNIST is lesser, and then you can do the resect the rest of the liver, either you can do an extended hepatectomy or you can do a right hepatectomy. So this is just to show the patient with bilobar liver metastasis in the segment 7 and segment 2-3. So initially this was resected, left lateral lobe was cleared, then the volumetry was done, then the portal vein embolization was done, and then the patient went on to have an extended right hepatectomy. We published our results on two-stage hepatectomy and digestive surgery, and basically this was the protocol which was used, And this initially all of this patient had systemic chemotherapy, then they had first level resection. This was being followed by systemic chemotherapy. And did the volumetric analysis and PVE was done. Then the FLR was less at 30%. And this is just a flow chart of the patient. I won't go into the details, but I'll just show you the survival. And the survival of the patient who had two-stage resection was very good in comparison to the patient who did went on to have the second stage resection. And this is comparable to the survival which is published in the literature. This is just a summary data of two-stage hepatectomy published results of all the two-stage hepatectomy. And basically the survival is around 35% to maybe around 58% at 5 years. So what about patient who developed recurrence after liver resection? And the data suggests that if you go on and resect those, if you do second or third liver resection, even then you can achieve a good long-term survival. So this is the summary data on patient with having second liver resection, and you can see there is a good around about 35% survival in 5 years after second liver resection. So what is the role of ablation? As you know, there are a lot of patients who won't be eligible for resection because of various reasons. Either they got decreased liver reserve, location of the tumor, because of the number, distribution, or because of extrahepatic disease and comorbidity. And as the previous speaker said, role of ablation has been increasing and has been quite successful in HCC, and it has been used regularly with the CRC max as well. So this is the data published from MD Anderson Center. You can see large volume data of 418 patients, out of which about 100 patients had RF combined with resection, 57 had RF only, and 70 had no RF for resection. And what they showed was the patient who had RF combined with resection had a better survival than the patient who had chemotherapy alone, but the survival was still inferior to the patient who had resection only. So patient who had primarily just resection, not combining with RF ablation, they had a better survival than the RF combining with RF ablation. And this is data from John Hopkins, again, large volume of patient, about 55 patients combining RF with resection, 192 resection alone, and 11 patients with RF alone. They actually showed that the overall survival was similar in the two groups between the RF ablation and the resection group, but the disease-free survival was inferior in the patient who had RF combined with the resection. And one of the problems with RF ablation is whether the size of tumor matters, and it has been shown that if you've got a large size tumor, then the rate of local recurrence is about 37%. And even in tumors which are less than 3 centimeters in size, the rate of recurrence is quite high in comparison to the liver resection alone. And thus the approach makes a difference, whether if you do a percutaneous RF ablation and or you do a laparoscopic or a laparotomy RF as an open procedure, and it seems that it does make a difference if you do a percutaneous versus a laparoscopy or an open RF ablation. And this is the interesting data which has been published. This is a phase 2 RCT trial, basically comparing RF ablation with systemic chemotherapy. It's about 60 odd patients in both the group, and you can see that the overall survival, there was no difference between the RF ablation and the systemic chemotherapy alone. And so this is the only randomized data we have got on this. But the only difference was that the progression-free survival was better in the RF group compared to the systemic chemotherapy group. And the only crux in this study is that the overall survival actually approaches 60 months, which is much higher than what you will expect from the current literature. You don't expect patient with unresectable disease surviving for 60 months in colorectal liver metastasis. So that is only bias in this study. So what about resection in the presence of extrahepatic disease? It has been shown that if you can resect all the disease, then you can achieve a good 5-year survival of around 20%. And most of the studies which have been published have addressed on whether about the lymph node disease, that is the Hala lymph node disease, or patient with pulmonary metastasis. This is again very intense data about Hala lymph node disease, and you can see that the yellow line is liver only disease, and the blue line is liver plus lymph node disease, and the survival is quite inferior in the patient who has got Hala lymph node disease. But still, it is an 18% 5-year survival if it is resected. And again, the disease-free survival is quite inferior in the patient who has got lymph node disease. In the presence of lung metastasis, this again the summary data on all the publications on lung metastasis. Again, it shows very good survival in patients who had resectable disease, resectable lung disease. So what makes a difference in patients with the extrahepatic disease? And it seems the number makes a difference, not the site. So it doesn't matter what the site of the disease is. It seems that what it matters is how many lesions are there. So if you've got one in about 1 to 3 lesions, we've got as the number of metastasis increases, the survival actually decreases. So if you compare patient with one metastatic disease to patient with greater than 6, then again, the survival decreases as the number of metastasis increases. So it doesn't matter what is the site of the disease. So irrespective of whether it is a Hala lymph node disease or whether it is a pulmonary metastasis, as long as they are resectable, you can achieve good long-term survival. So in patients with synchronous liver metastasis, the big discussion is about what should be the timing of the resection. And this has been a paper published in Lancet actually, and again it was published in the Clinical Colorectal Surgery. And what they did was they created a model of patients with synchronous colorectal metastasis, and they came up with 13 possible equations where give chemotherapy, do a colectomy, and then do a hepatectomy, and either or the other things are like you do the hepatectomy, you give chemotherapy, then you do colectomy, and then you give chemotherapy. So there are 13 possible equations, and basically what it says is there is nothing which is in favor of any of this which favors the treatment regime. So you can go on and do any of those, but what the literature has suggested that if you got a synchronous disease, you should, and you got an asymptomatic primary, you should probably first give chemotherapy, and then if possible do hepatectomy, and then go for colectomy if it is an asymptomatic primary. So the debate about whether to do a simultaneous or a stage liver section, and these are the major series which have been published on patients with simultaneous and stage liver section, and you can see the numbers are quite big there actually. But if you see the largest series, there are 475 patients with stage disease and 135 with simultaneous. You can see the morbidity of patient undergoing major hepatectomy along with simultaneous colonic resection. They got a major morbidity there. And that is one of the biggest limitations of doing simultaneous colonic resection along with liver resection. And most centers actually prefer to do minor liver resection along with resecting the primary. So the concept of liver first approach have come, and basically this is based on lots of issues, and it is patient with colorectal metastasis. If they have stage liver resection, then the chances is their liver metastasis may progress. They may never come to the resection, and that's what is the major determinant of their prognosis. So there are lots of issues in this. I won't go into detail of this, but what I will do is I will show you the data from MD Anderson Center, and they've been doing this liver first approach since 1999, and over the time their numbers have increased. The top one is the reverse strategy approach, and it's to resect the liver first and then wait and do the chemotherapy and do the colonic resection. And the numbers have been increasing over the time. And if you look at the data closely, the number of lesions and the size of the lesion and type of liver resection, there's a significant difference between the three groups. In all these three things, the number is bigger in the reverse strategy group. So more number of lesion there. The median size of the lesion is bigger here, and there are more patients undergoing major devastation. And the postoperative morbidity and mortality, there was no difference between the two groups. And the overall survival was no difference between the three groups. I'll leave that. So, in summary, I'd say liver resection provides the main possibility of cure for patients with colorectal liver metastasis. Multimodality management has improved outcome. As long as R0 resection can be achieved, there is no absolute contraindication. In patients with inadequate future liver remnant, portal vein embolization and two-stage resection plus minus ablation can improve survival. And the simultaneous and reverse strategy are gaining favors and can be beneficial in selected patients. Thank you very much. So the other strategy, I think why this is gaining favor is because even in patient when coming with obstruction, in West it is becoming norm to put stents in and then to do elective resection rather than doing emergency heart moves. So if the stent is successful, then the patient becomes asymptomatic, and then you can get on with the chemotherapy, do the liver resection first, and then you can do the colonic resection. Yeah, so I'll go with the chemo radiation first. And if the patient remains asymptomatic, he doesn't develop any symptoms from his primary, it remains okay, then if the liver metastasis is resected, then I'll go for the liver resection. And then and later on, I'll resect the primary. That is what. That's interesting. So what the data suggests is you get a peak at 20, hypertrophy happens within the first 21 days.
So in that time, the chances of tumor growth is?
Yeah. So that is what the data I showed, that there is a chance of tumor being growth during that time. And that is why you should do a sandwich chemotherapy during that time. Start the chemotherapy, have two cycles of chemotherapy, do the portal vein embolization, wait for another 2-3 cycles, and then to around 10 to 12 weeks. And then if you do portal vein embolization, the standard teaching used to be 6 weeks. No, if you see most big series, they used to wait for 6 weeks. But now, when people are not using chemotherapy, they go in early. They may go in within 3 weeks of portal vein embolization because of chemoprogression, the risk of chemoprogression. Because if you see about 30% of the patient actually progresses and don't become resectable after portal vein embolization. So if you're not using chemotherapy, then just go early, within 3 weeks after portal vein embolization.
Is there
I'm not sure whether tumor-related data is there for cholangios, but the other data which is there for cholangios, so if you're doing portal vein embolization with cholangio, you should preferably drain both the lobes. Standard teaching used to be that you should drain the opposite side lobe, and you should just leave the lobe which you are going to embolize. But the data actually suggests that because there is the increased risk of sepsis, development of liver abscesses, the rate of development of liver abscesses is very high when you do portal vein embolization. So you should drain both the sides of the lobe. You should do TTPD on both the sides.
So
but I'm not sure
six
the
weeks,
data on.
Three weeks,
I'm not sure on the data.
6 weeks.
But the wait period, as far as wait period is concerned, it applies same because the hypertrophy rate of hypertrophy is. You get maximum hypertrophy in first 21 days.
Do you have tumor growth in cholangios the same way as you have colorectal
metastasis? Because cholangio is a very slow growing tumor. So, but as far as data is concerned, I don't know. I can just make a call on it that it is a slow growing tumor, you might not be getting the same thing as colorectal metastasis. I thought I will bore you, so So basically, liver transplantation for colorectal metastasis has been done, and way back in 1990s, approximately 50 patients had undergone liver transplantation for CRC NETs, but the 5-year survival was only 18%. And this is, if you look at the history of liver transplantation, initially all the transplants were done for cancer. HCC was one of the first indications to have it, but the patient selection wasn't there and there was a high rate of recurrence, and HCC fallback as an indication for transplantation. So here also the 5-year survival was only 18%, and because of that centers stopped doing liver transplantation. And then this protocol, which was published by from Norway, which basically involves using rapamune as a standard immunosuppression from postoperative day one in patients with CRC NETs. And they had a very strict criteria of selecting patient for liver transplantation. That is, primary should be R0, one or more chemotherapies for metastatic disease, non-resectable liver metastasis, no extrahepatic disease, and good general condition. And what they showed was, at 24 months, the survival was 94%, which is much, much better than the previous experience. But there is a high rate of recurrence. Recurrence rate is high. 10 of the 16 patients had recurrent disease, that is about 63%. And only 6 of the 15 patients have no evidence of disease. So maybe this protocol becomes more standardized, and maybe the more centers will start doing it. I would have thought we should not be doing it unless you got a protocol based therapy on this.
Sir, there are two questions. What is the sir clear indication for neoadjuvant chemotherapy in liver? Not fit for surgery.
Right.
Unresectability in colorectal liver mets. Like in the era of today, that extrahepatic metastasis are also resectable, and multiple liver mets will also go for surgery.
So the best thing will be you start with chemotherapy and you see the response to chemotherapy. That is your best judgment on whether the patient, if the patient develops response to chemotherapy, that means they've got a good prognosis disease, and you should offer resection. If the patient progresses on chemotherapy, that means they've got a bad prognosis disease, and you should probably be on it.
Now we invite you all for a welcome dinner at Shivalik View Hotel in Sector 17, Chandigarh. All the faculty members and delegates are invited. And at 8:30 p.m. I would also like to remind you to regather tomorrow at 9 p.m. for starting the course.